Hello, I'm Jason Solomons, and welcome to the latest episode of Seen Anything Good Lately. On this edition of my cultural chat show, I welcome acting giant David Thewlis and award-winning British jazz star Ashley Henry to find out about their most recent films and books, in David's case, and for Ashley, the latest concerts and album. And I ask them both if they've seen anything good lately.
You know what I've been watching the past few nights, which I've never ever seen? You know, I could just start watching The Peep Show.
I watched DJ Premier and RZA, which was literally a masterclass in beat making. I just lost my mind.
It's so all on IGTV?
Yeah, all on IGTV.
This is the podcast for you if you're looking for recommendations on what to watch or what books to turn to or some new music to try out. It's about guests sharing their passions for the things they've discovered and got hooked on. And don't you agree, there's nothing like hearing someone talk animatedly about the latest series they've got into or a new artist they're desperate to tell you about and share with you. That's the energy we harness on Seen Anything Good Lately. And I'd love your reactions and passions too. So get in touch through the website page and email sagl@jasonsolomons.com. That's sagl@jasonsolomons.com. And let me know if you agree with my guests and me or not. And tell me what we need to be watching or hearing instead. Right, here's what I've seen lately. There's been a lot of Muhammad Ali stuff on Sky recently, and I was rather taken amid it all with the doc Ali and Cavett, The Tale of the Tapes. It's about the interviews between the champ and the TV chat show host Dick Cavett, who was on American TV in the 70s. He was never a huge chat show host, but he was one of the sort of nicest and finest and funniest, and the guests on his were great. He wasn't as big as, you know, Johnny Carson, but he was great, and this is a very 70s time capsule, I must say, and it's wonderfully revealing about the champ and just obviously showcases his charisma, but also the highs and lows. He talks about his defeats on there quite a lot. So that's Ali and Cavett, The Tale of the Tapes. I watched The Hate U Give, a film starring Amanda Stenberg. It's a young adult Black Lives Matter movie, and I watched it with my kids in the wake of George Floyd and the Black Lives Matter in a bid to start a conversation. And I thought it was the best film for younger viewers to get to grips with some of the issues and what was going on, and it really provoked a wonderful conversation as a family, perhaps the most grown-up conversation we've ever had as a family. It was a tough and emotional ride for the kids to watch because it's quite long, but it was searingly relevant, and you know, they really drank it all in and really got to grips with it. So that was great, The Hate U Give. And sort of tangentially to that, I've gone back to the Do the Right Thing soundtrack. I used to have it on cassette in my car, my first car. I played it all the time. But obviously the cassette got called and munched up, and I haven't really gone back to the whole soundtrack. Obviously, I still love Fight the Power, the theme song by Public Enemy. But I've forgotten how good some of the tunes on that soundtrack were, or how of the time, 89, they were. There's My Fantasy by Guy. Perry, a sort of soul singer who did Feel So Good on there. And there's an Al Jarreau track on there, Never Explain Love. I'd forgotten about that. And of course, the jingle by Take Six for Radio We Love. So that's what I've been up to, but it's time to introduce now my first guest on this show and find out if he's seen anything good lately. David Thewlis is basically a legend. He's one of my favourite actors. He broke through in the early 90s with Mike Leigh's Naked and built a career as a distinctive screen presence in nearly 100 films since, including 7 Years in Tibet opposite Brad Pitt, Remus Lupin in the Harry Potter series. He was in War Horse, The Boy in the Striped Pyjamas, Anomalisa for director Charlie Kaufman, Besieged for Bernardo Bertolucci, Gangster Number One, Justin Kurzel's recent Macbeth, as well as Fargo on TV and the BBC's An Inspector Calls. It's hard to leave any Thewlis performance out, no matter how major the role, as he always makes such a distinctive mark. He's now playing Jim, a restaurant inspector calling, in The Guest of Honour by Canadian director Atom Egoyan, in which the meticulous Jim must unravel the mystery of his daughter's imprisonment. It's a role that brings out the best in David Thewlis. David, how lovely to see you.
Lovely to see you.
And congratulations, congratulations on Jim. What a great part that is in The Guest of Honour.
Yeah, I'm very fond of him. He's a little different to what I usually play. I usually play kind of some kind of strung out freaky psychos, and he's relatively normal, this fellow. I mean, he's still got his moments, his eccentricities, but he's relatively straight laced for me.
Was he like that on the page, or did you think, when you cast David Thewlis, sometimes you think, well, he should be a bit eccentric and you kind of go for something a bit outlandish. But what was he like when you got the script? Was it Atom Egoyan and said to you, I just want him to play a sort of fairly normal character, because the layers grow on him, don't they, after a while?
Yeah, and that's what I like about it. I mean, because you come to discover him through, if you're familiar with Atom Egoyan's work, he works in this kind of prismatic time scale almost always with all his films. So you never, I think there are about, I'm not sure, about five time scales in this film. So you're never quite sure which one you're in at any time.
Is there a person that you research? Can you research a sort of role like this one? I mean, I've never seen you doing this sort of thing before.
No, it's not a popular choice of occupation for film roles. Apparently Donald Sutherland did play a lead part as a restaurant inspector, and I forget which movie that was in, because actually Donald Sutherland's son, Rasif, is in the movie. And he told me that his father had played a restaurant inspector, so I nearly called Donald for some advice.
The point is that it is an Atom Egoyan film, so therefore you know that there's just going to be the peeling back of time scales and layers. Were you familiar with his work from way back?
I was, yeah. I'd seen pretty much, I've not seen everything, so he's done so much, but I then have seen everything since. And, I always adored his work. I think you could always tell an Atom Egoyan film, even if you didn't see the credits. This, the time scale thing is always present. It's a beautiful way of telling a story, and particularly this story, because there are some secrets to be revealed.
It is a bit confusing. It is a bit confusing when you watch it.
Yeah, exactly.
But I think you have to let that happen, don't you? Some films are just like, well, I know I'm going to be confused because it's Atom Egoyan. I'm going to let it unfurl itself and reveal itself to me.
Yeah, and I think it becomes a little more unpredictable in that way, because, you know, we've got so wise at working things out these days in linear storytelling. If it's some kind of whodunit, you're always looking out for who is the most unlikely, therefore it's got to be them. And, you know, it's really hard to pull that trick off, I find, these days. Although I thought that film Knives Out did that rather wonderfully recently in terms of, tricking you, wrong-footing you as it went on.
And I was just reminded, obviously, should have come to an end last weekend, one of your glory nights, winning the best actor there in, what, 93 for Naked?
93, yeah.
And I wondered if whenever Cannes comes around, I mean, obviously it didn't come around this year, if that delivers a little pang for you.
Oh, it does, because that was such a very, very special time. I only went quite recently, about 3-4 years ago. I went back for Macbeth, Justin Kurzel's Macbeth with Michael Fassbender and Marion Cotillard. And I was there just for one night. I was flown in and I just did the whole red carpet thing and I had to fly out the next morning. And then I got a pang because, you know, it never changes. And it was, I've got to say, one of the great nights of my life, winning that, mainly because it was so, so completely unexpected. I never dreamed of something like that would happen to me, and it was a good night. I got very drunk with Gary Oldman, I seem to remember.
Well remembered. At least you remembered it.
When Gary was drinking. Yeah. I only got this photographic evidence.
Well, the other thing I was thinking about the other day was I was rewatching with my kids The Boy in the Striped Pyjamas.
Yes.
Which I think is an extraordinarily powerful performance from you. Really difficult one, though. Really difficult to play that and come out with him, with that character intact. I mean, he's such a villain, but you managed to make him all right, didn't you?
When you play a villain, a bad guy, whatever you call it, there's always part of you as an actor that tries to find something in there that you can identify with and find something likable, even that you can relate to. And of course, with that guy, you couldn't at all. But what I did read, there is actually an autobiography by Rudolf Hoss, who was the commandant of Auschwitz. And I say autobiography, it literally is an autobiography. It sounds very sort of celebrity these days, but he was ordered to write it after the Nuremberg trials. And it's a fascinating book. I recommend anyone to read it. In fact, Primo Levi recommends everyone to read it, because it's real insight into the mind of a bureaucrat who was more concerned with buying the right type of barbed wire. It's a very hard character to get my head around, really. But I was playing a father, and a father who loved his children. It's a very hard one to get your head around.
Yeah, it's one of those ones that lasts and lasts. I don't know if when you've done. I've been researching this. Not much research. I saw on IMDb. It says 97 films that you've done.
Is it? I thought it was 100 by now. Well, maybe only 97 are out by now, and I've got four coming out. So I think I'm going to hit 100 with. I did a film with Charlie Kaufman, and I think that last year, and I think that's going to be my 100th. Because I remember thinking
a follow-up to Anomalisa.
Yeah. It's called I'm Thinking of Ending Things, and it's with myself, Tony Collette, Jesse Plemons and Jesse Buckley. And I remember when I was doing that, I looked at IMDb and thought, and I'd just done the thing called Eternal Beauty with Craig Roberts with Sally Hawkins, and then I did this thing called Rare Beasts with Billy Piper directing. And then Charlie Kaufman's film seemed to me to hit 100. So that will be 100 films. And I thought, well, that's pretty cool, man. My 100th film was Charlie Kaufman.
100's quite good, David. It's quite a good innings.
Yeah. And it's gone above that now because I've done some things beyond that. But yeah, no, I am proud to have done that. Maybe I'll celebrate when Charlie's film comes out and when it clicks onto 100 on IMDb.
Right, I'll be there with you. I think that's definitely worth marking, especially when, you know, it's probably not something you ever thought you were gonna, you know, clock up.
No, I never thought I was gonna do one film. I remember going to see a film just after I left drama school. You know, back then there was only Gary Oldman and Tim Roth who were in movies. I remember going to the cinema and seeing a film with Tim Roth in it. I can't remember what it was called, with John Hurt in it also. I just sat there, and I'd just left drama school, and going, imagine if you could be in a movie. That would just be the most extraordinary thing. It'll never happen, but just imagine. That's incredible, because that guy, Tim Roth, he's not so much older than me, and there he is in a movie at the cinema. And now everyone's in a movie, you know.
What have you been watching? Have you seen anything good lately, David Thewlis?
You know what I've been watching the past few nights, which I've never, ever seen? My wife just started watching The Peep Show, which has really dated us right from episode one. I'm only on episode four right now. I've never seen it. And I think I'd sort of watched it once, and I thought all that thing of the camera point of view was getting on my nerves. Yeah. I turned it off, and I've come to kind of love David Mitchell on Would I Lie to You over the years and his writing, and I just adore his comedy. And I was like, actually, check that Peep Show thing out that I never gave a chance back in the early 2000s. So I've been watching that.
And how really, is it? Is it funny?
Oh, it's fantastic. Yeah. I'm really loving it.
And you've got Oscar-winning actress in there, in Olivia Colman.
Yes, indeed. Yes. Who I hopefully I'm going to be working with soon. So that was also another incentive. I forgot Olivia was in it, but there's something that hopefully is going to happen in depending on what's happening with filming right now in the whole world, you know, when things happen, because things are all getting clashing together from commitments we made long ago and things that are lined up and things. So it's very confusing with the future of one's work.
Yeah. And how are you feeling about going into something with a socially distanced bit of acting?
Well, I just don't know how it's going to work, really. I'm really genuinely puzzled, because film sets, TV sets, they're, you know, they're by their nature intimate. Everyone has to be, I don't see how you could, really. I've heard that, you know, ways we're going to do it, there's going to be crews wearing PPE and crews going into quarantine. Like we're now with Jim Cameron and John Lander just arriving in New Zealand for Avatar. I know they've got to go into quarantine for 14 days, especially since they're coming from the States into New Zealand, the most, you know, where the cases are the worst to where the cases are the best. And so there's no one in New Zealand, I don't think, right now. So they're going into 14 days quarantine. And I hear that might be the case in the next thing I do, is that we have to, the actors and the crew are all quarantined for those weeks. And then we have to stay safe whilst we're making the show. But I don't know how you can't be socially distanced from another actor if you're doing certain scenes, you know, or fighting and kissing and hugging and shouting in each other's faces. I don't know. It's impossible. You can't be wearing, you've got to just make lockdown dramas from now on. Yeah. People wearing masks, you know.
Doing it on Zoom like this. Being in celebrity squares for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
What else have you been watching then? So you've started on Peep Show. You must have had a look at a few films over this period.
I have. I saw Midsommar the other night. Let's go back in terms of what I can remember. Florence Pugh, I'd never seen before. She was fantastic. And Jack Rayner, who put my son in Macbeth, so I wrote him a text going like, I just saw you in Midsommar. That was all perfectly reasonable. No, I have no questions whatsoever. This jacket. Well, anyone who's not seen it, I won't say what happens to Jack Rayner.
Yeah.
I watched Rules of the Game.
Le Règle du Jeu. Yeah.
I watched that. You know, my wife is French, which gives me a right to watch very arty classic French films, because she educates me on what I should be watching. Not the sort of thing I would ever put on, but she's like, oh, you've got to watch the classics.
Oh, with Jean Gabin. It's just brilliant. I mean,
another bonkers one. I mean, really, that's quite, you know, I thought it was like some very serious detective story. It's clearly just cr- cr- as that film.
Yeah, no, they're not as, you know, they might be arty because they're French. We think they're French, but they're not actually that.
Yes, not arty at all.
It's kind of quite a big budget and all that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't know if you were like watching Normal People or one of those that got...
Oh, I did watch Normal People.
There you
actually
see.
Yes, that's what I watched. Yes, because it was really highly recommended to me by an old neighbour of mine who thought it was the greatest thing she'd ever seen and it changed her life. She wrote a rather wonderful piece about it. And so I thought I really, really should give that a look. I've not been such a fan of the book. I did read the book when it first came out. But I thought it was rather wonderfully done, actually. I thought those two actors were fantastic.
Weren't they great? Yeah.
Really, really fantastic. And I was all set not to like it. I was all like, well, let's see what they've done with that book. And my apologies to Sally Rooney for saying that. But
she wrote the screenplay as well. So, you know.
So excellent work, Sally. Not sure the book.
Lots of sex in there as well.
Yeah, well, that'll never happen again.
That's it, isn't it?
You won't be able to make that now, you see. It's all the tested.
And are you a reader, David Thewlis? What have you been reading?
Yes,
you have your nose in a book.
Well, in fact, I just finished writing a book. On the day of lockdown, I handed in my second novel. And it was actually a book that Atom Egoyan advised me to write because I told him about an idea I had for a film and I showed him some notes I had on it. And he's like, that's a book. It's a book. It's what you must do as a book. I've not been able to get down to any writing during this lockdown and not actually... much reading. I've only been able to sort of read short stories. I've not been able to get my, you know, tackle a
it's
novel.
Extraordinary. A lot of my guests on this slot have said that they've had real trouble sort of settling into reading. Maybe the concentration's gone or there's a lethargy set in, but reading seems to be one thing that's...
Short stories are all right. I've been reading the stories of William Trevor, and he's just an immense book. So that's kept me going.
Did he not do Felicity's Journey that Atom Egoyan directed?
Exactly. Well, it was Atom again who got me into William Trevor. And I was very surprised. I'd never heard of William Trevor, and I consider myself fairly well read and good education. But I'd never come across William Trevor. Now I just, you know, totally, utterly.
Yeah, I'd never heard of him until I remember seeing it's Bob Hoskins, wasn't it, in Felicity's Journey?
Yeah. And Elaine Cassidy.
Can I ask you what your novel's about? Well, I mean, who have you given it to, a publisher or to an agent or?
Yes. It's with my agent right now. The two main characters are an aging British film director of some renown, not based on anyone.
You don't know any of them.
And it's really not based on a particular person. I should say this for legal reasons.
Yeah.
And an actress in her 30s whom this director pays to go and live in his house in France and play his recently deceased wife on video call. I was like, I wonder if people know much about video calls. Now this is all happening. I was like, yeah, video calls, whatever.
They'll say that you wrote this during lockdown. They won't believe you. We've got the evidence now.
Yeah, exactly. It does worry me a bit because it's like it's a big central part of the plot. I mean, it's a man, and the calls are very lit by a cinematographer, and she drifts in and out of the shadows in a very noirish way, so that it's plausibly believed, and she does a very good impression of the wife. We get close to understanding the wife committed suicide, and the actress gets closer to understanding why the wife committed suicide as the film director is back in England shooting his final film.
Wow. We've had the whole plot there. Well, not the whole plot.
I've never
seen
it before. That's not spoiling too much.
No, sounds brilliant. Well, you've always had a lovely way with words anyway, David. You love speaking them and you're so brilliant with them. So, you know, I think it'd be fantastic writing them. Amazing to hear that. Thank you for sharing that. Enjoy the rest of Peep Show for some light entertainment.
Yeah, well, I'll catch up with you next year. It's nine, yeah. I think it's 9.
This is quite long. Yeah, it seems to be around for a long time.
I understand how David Mitchell looks like he looks now by the end.
Yeah, exactly.
About 15 in it right now.
And then we'll celebrate the 100th Thewlis movie when it comes out.
Yes.
For now, we'll look at your gym in Guest of Honour with Atom Egoyan and enjoy that. And good luck with that as it comes out in a million homes. It's streaming. It's not going in the cinema, I guess. So it's been in cinema.
No, it's going into Curzon. Yeah,
but it's been at Venice and it's been at Toronto. So you've had the big screen experience with it.
Yeah, I've heard people clapping.
Yeah, well done. Really lovely to catch up with you. Thanks so much for coming on the show. And keep well, yeah?
Take care.
Cheers, bye-bye. David. And Guest of Honour, starring David Thewlis, is on Curtain Home Cinema right now. Watch out for his new novel a bit later. My next guest on this show is the supremely talented pianist Ashley Henry. He's 28, very tall, from South London, and during the recent lockdown, he played a live stream gig as part of the Royal Albert Hall's Royal Albert Home series. His album, Beautiful Vinyl Hunter, earned Ashley awards nominations and reviews such as one of the best jazz albums in years, with its mix of jazz styles, London hip-hop, soulful vocals, and Solange covers. I caught up with Ashley as he was preparing his performance for the Royal Albert Hall by making the world-famous venue in his own living room, and to find out what other types of culture influenced this wide-rangingly funky musician. How's it going to work? How do you do it from home? What's the technical specifics of doing Royal Albert Home?
Royal Albert Home is, we just have to have like decent enough equipment for good audio and good sound, as long as you're seen clearly and that the sound quality is good. That's what the people at Royal Albert Hall mostly are worried about, because it's about the experience, you know what I mean? And the listener needs to still feel connected even though they're watching from home.
And what's gonna happen to the city? Have you spoken to like everyone? I mean, you know, you're not alone. You would have been touring with a band. A lot of your friends, your mates would have been gigging all over London. You know, that's such a scene we had exploding, particularly in that jazz scene.
Definitely.
I feel that this is might not put a dampener on it. Maybe it'll make people want for more. What's the vibe? What your colleagues saying?
It's interesting actually how I think it's amazing how we as a musicians community have been dealing with this situation in a very communal way, and how everyone's been reaching out to each other, showing support, watching each other's streams, buying each other's merch, you know, just showing that initial support because we're all going through the same thing and have that underlying understanding. And I think everyone's kind of in the same boat in terms of using the time now to keep the creative juices flowing and to find other ways to be creative. A lot of people like myself, you know, we're sending stuff back and forth to people from different countries because, you know, everyone else is around, everyone else is at home. So it's actually a good opportunity for doing those collaborations that you always thought, I really want to do something with this person, but everyone's always touring and sometimes it just doesn't work out. So, you know, now's a good time to utilize that. And
so what also, you're getting hooked up with people. You're saying, can I email you some stuff? I'm going to send you like a composition and maybe you can put some lyrics to it. Or is that how it works?
Yeah, exactly. You send like little files back and forth and people add to it. And then before you know it, you have like a fully fledged tune or a demo, or, you know, as soon as this gets wiped out, you can actually go in the studio and maybe record it, or maybe you're happy with how it is.
Wow. Yeah. So we might get some like lockdown collabs that are, you know, pretty good, well enough produced anyway. Their technology is pretty much there to do it that way.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. There's going to be so much music coming out. And if tours are actually going to happen from autumn onwards, it's going to be a very busy autumn.
But you'll just be, I suppose you'll just relish it even more, having been suddenly denied that experience, especially when you've got a beautiful new album like you, and you want to tour it and give it to people. Are they dance? Are they sitting? Are they nodding? Are they clapping? You know, I guess you hadn't quite formed yet exactly how this album was going to be received.
Yeah, I mean, I had no preconceptions how the album's going to be received, but I've been loving the reception so far, having, you know, getting BBC Radio 6 albums of the year, winning album of the year for the Jazz Japan Awards, and, you know, taking my music to New York with Giles Peterson, and just the initial reception from people has been absolutely amazing. And I just couldn't wait to just take it to festivals. And now
I was really looking forward to seeing you at festivals. I thought I definitely can go. I'm going to dance to it as well, because there's so many different influences in there. And I guess you'd have had sort of guest vocalists up there, and I don't know if you'd have been doing Between the Lines, what you did with Kay and Harold, doing that live.
That's what I love how everyone has their different favorites from the album. I can ask 10 different people what their favorite track is and I'll get 10 different answers. So I kind of like the fact that people are kind of guessing what's going to happen on stage what tunes is actually going to play, because sometimes we like to just switch it up.
Which is what you're going to, I guess this is the perfect opportunity now to do it solo. I don't know.
Exactly.
You might never have done this one. So actually, this is even a bit of a challenge to you. I mean, I'm going to tell you that my favorite on the album, in terms of like the pure jazzness of Ashley Henry, is Sunrise. And I reckon that works pretty well, say it solo.
Yeah, I've actually played that solo before a few times, so that's definitely going to be thrown in the mix.
Well, should we have a little listen to Sunrise? I haven't got the solo version yet. I've only got the album version, but I'm going to play Sunrise now. Just play that and we'll come back to you. That was Ashley Henry and Sunrise. Is that track about London Sunrise? That's what I think it is.
Yeah. So what happened with that track is that when I was a kid growing up in South London, the number one radio station for the black community at the time was Choice FM. And every single morning from the kitchen, like, we always had like a radio on whenever, you know, everyone was getting up and having breakfast and stuff. And Choice FM was always playing from downstairs. And every time I woke up in the morning, I could hear the music playing from Choice FM. And at the time, you know, UK garage was kind of booming. So there was a lot of that being played. So every time I'd wake up to go to school, I'd always hear that kind of, that same similar kind of drum loop, you know, the kind of UK garage feel. So I wanted to do a tune that incorporated that with the jazz that I love, and so that's how it came around.
Yeah, no, that's definitely. And I noticed that you've done a playlist on Spotify that has got like your influences behind Beautiful Vinyl Hunter, and I got down to the bottom and it was there was Moving Too Fast by Artful Dodger, and I thought there's his check in the UK garage scene right there.
Yeah, it's even if you wanted to ignore it, you couldn't, like, especially growing up in South London and UK garage at the time, before grime came about, was such a big landmark in the ever-growing theme of Black British identity.
Absolutely, but throughout that list, there's, you know, you've got, it's a great list because there's like, there's The Streets are in there. There's Omar in there. You definitely check him. There's Chopin, I noticed, which is a quite
good
mix.
Yeah, yeah. I'm a classical pianist first.
And then comes in the Nas and the Pharrell and the Jay-Z.
I've got such a wide range of influences. It's it's crazy, especially living in the generation I live in, where it's like, I remember when Spotify first came around, or when the iPod first came around, where you could actually listen to so many different types of music without having to change the CD or change your tape or whatnot. So growing up, like, in your teens, in a time where you could literally listen to a hip hop track and then skip and then listen to a grime track and then skip it again and then listen to something else, it's amazing how being a jazz musician as well, you can just incorporate all of that. There's no rules, no boundaries. And
yeah, is that for you? I mean, that seems to me what your whole kind of new generation of jazz musicians sound is. I guess jazz was always doing it, but it does seem that you can magpie from anywhere. You can really absorb all the influences that you've got. As you say, you can hop from one to the other.
Yeah, definitely. It definitely loops back to what I was saying with just that ongoing growing theme of like Black British identity, which is still happening now, and all we're doing as jazz musicians is reflecting that. So to incorporate all of that with our jazz is just a natural thing to do.
Yeah,
especially with all the new subgenres that we have to draw influences on as well.
Yeah, well, it's sounding fantastic on your album, I have to say. So I agree with
all
the awards. I know you're obviously listening to a lot of stuff, but Ashley Henry, have you seen anything good lately?
Timbaland and Swiss Beats actually are, I don't know if you know, like, they've done this really amazing, like, Instagram live series where they get two producers, like, literally two of the most amazing producers, and they go back to back and play, like, all the hits that they've produced, and people decide who wins. So the beat battles on that has been amazing. I watched Lil Jon and T-Pain, which was cool. It was like a throwback to secondary school. I watched I watched DJ Premier and RZA, which was literally a masterclass in beat making. I just lost my mind.
It's
so
all on IGTV, Instagram TV.
Yeah, yeah, all on IGTV. And there's actually some really amazing online exhibitions on the Tech Modern website as well. There's a really good exhibition with Ed Rusher, which is cool. It really incorporates like sound, visuals, and words, how that incorporates together.
I love the illustration on your album cover, which has got that sort of modernist art feel. Are you into graphic art then?
Yeah, I love art. I love going to exhibitions when I can, when I'm not touring. When I'm not touring, I'm literally at an exhibition. And the last thing I actually saw in the flesh was Steve McQueen's exhibition at the Tech Modern, which is amazing, man.
Yeah, just, I mean, you just incredible. Because it was only just open, really. You got in there pretty quick.
Yeah, literally, I had to get in there quick. So yeah, I love art and how I can incorporate that with my music and visuals as well. Like visuals play such a big part of my music, as well as, you know, different influences, sounds.
You've been watching any good films?
I watched, I'm a documentaries guy. So the last thing I watched was that Birth of the Cool Miles Davis documentary. It was amazing.
That's Stanley Nelson. It's a great film, isn't it?
Yeah. And looping back to the visual side of things, some of the photography in there is just ridiculous. In Birth of the Cool.
Yeah, is it? I mean, just the still photography in there is just great, and the way it moves and tells the story. I just thought it was because I watched it and I thought, oh, am I learning anything new about Miles that I didn't know? But the way it was just kind of going through his albums and his story and his women, and it just kept adding new layers to this person, you know, and this. And by the end, it was like an entirely new portrait of him. I thought it was amazing, beautiful stuff.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, to be honest, 2 hours isn't enough time to tell the story of Miles Davis. So there's always going to be that thing of, oh, you could have put more of this in there. You could have, you know, talked about this more. But, you know, it's Miles Davis. Like, you could do a documentary series about him, just about each phase of his life.
I noticed there's on your curated playlist on Spotify, there's a Miles track. I think it's Steps Ahead you've gone for, actually, on that. Must have been difficult to choose which one.
Yeah. Oh, God, so many tracks to choose from, but. The first Miles track I definitely fell in love with was Seven Steps to Heaven. And I think that's just when he was just starting the second great quintet as well. So, you know, you had, what, a 23-year-old Herbie Hancock and a 16-year-old Tony Williams, and just the energy. And, I just remember just that energy you got from just listening to it. I was just like, whoa, what is this? Yeah.
And I think that comes across in the film. You know, I think that those different quartets, I think the energy of the young Miles really comes, and the beauty of it as well. There's one bit where someone says, oh, he was just, I think it's even Herbie Hancock sort of says, oh, he was just like sexy. You know, you just want to, you know, you wish someone could kiss me like his trumpet did, I think someone says. So it's pretty, pretty sexy stuff actually in that film. A great choice, that really, really fine choice. The other thing I want to talk to you about is that on that playlist, you've got quite a bit of Earth, Wind and Fire, Ashley Henry, which I pay full respect to. What is it about Earth, Wind and Fire?
With Earth, Wind and Fire, my family have like the biggest vinyl collection at home. So literally we've got, the garage is literally just full of vinyl. And I grew up studying classical piano, but then I would then, when there was music playing in the house, like my family would play vinyls around in the house and stuff. And they'd play a lot of Earth, Wind and Fire because my dad just loves Earth, Wind and Fire. So it'd be played in the same room that the piano was there. So I would learn all those songs by ear.
Yeah.
So I was kind of doing that before I studied jazz. I didn't start listening or studying jazz till I was about 18. So during that whole time growing up, I was kind of, without realizing, I was kind of learning the nuts and bolts of how a song works and different chords. And I couldn't tell you what those chords were, but, you know, I understood the colors.
Yes, the colors. And in fact, even if you look at the album covers on Earth, Wind and Fire, they are so colorful, aren't they? They kind of go from hot oranges into night misty blues. It's all about the colors.
Yeah, exactly. So like Earth, Wind and Fire, Stevie Wonder, Marvin Gaye, all of their stuff has a lot of jazz harmony in it, which I didn't realize you know, till I was a lot older when it all came full circle. I was like, oh, it's just this.
Ashley Henry, it's been brilliant to have you on Seen Anything Good lately. Really lovely to speak to you, mate. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you, man. Thanks so much for having me.
And you can see that Ashley Henry performance on the Albert Hall's website, royalalberthall.com. That's it for another podcast of Seen Anything Good Lately. Check out the SAGLE page on jasonsolomons.com for all those recommendations from my superbly knowledgeable guests with their impeccable tastes. And also, let me know yours. Tell me if you've seen anything good lately. Email sagle@jasonsolomons.com. And I'll see you soon with brilliant guests still to come on this series, including Woody Allen, Mark Cousins, the rap star Speech from Arrested Development, Greta Scacchi, and Gangs of London director Gareth Evans, and White Riot filmmaker Rubika Shah. There's so much more on Seen Anything Good Lately.